So the next speaker is Roberto Fedele.
Thank you.
I will talk about urinary Lagrangian transformations of second gradient equations.
Thank you very much, Giuseppe. In this contribution, I will present some results within a collaboration with Professor Dell'Isola concerning second gradient modeling of elastic materials and, in particular, transformation of governing equation from the Eulerian to the Lagrangian description. So the main problem that I will try to face in this study is, for instance, you can think to the structural problem in which you apply loading on the current Eulerian configuration. This loading for second gradient materials, so nobody knows how can be transferred to the Lagrangian configuration. And we have obtained some, let's say, surprising results that I will try to justify in a very simple way, I hope. So, as usual, the deformation process can be described as a diffeomorphism between a material reference configuration referred to as Lagrangian and another configuration referred to usually as spatial or current or Eulerian configuration. This diffeomorphism between some manifolds is a biaction, so it's invertible and continuous and can be differentiated with its inverse also. As Gabriel Piola showed in his work, some of his works, the energy density can be expressed as a function of deformation gradient and its derivatives. In this study, we focus on the so-called second gradient materials. So we described the energy density as a function of the first gradient of placement map and the second gradient of placement map. As usual, the Jacobian determinant is assumed to be strictly positive. So, according to the approach proposed originally by Piola, the equilibrium configuration is obtained as the optimal placement map, which makes minimum this functional, which is in the modern language is the total potential energy, that is the difference between the stored energy and the external work. I think it's important to underline that this is, in a sense, a symbolic equation, because especially for, let's say, not trivial constitutive law and materials, so we don't know in advance which class of external actions our body can sustain. So, in a sense, this equation, this functional, will be completed, described only when we will have described the inner work by means of non-reducible terms over the volume, over the surface, over the boundary wedges, edges and wedges. So the first thing to do is to prescribe stationarity of this functional. We can consider the first variation of the inner work, and we can observe immediately that the the first gradient on placement map, that is the deformation gradient, is no more sufficient to govern the inner work, but there is a new tensor, a third order tensor here, which is the second gradient of the virtual placement map. It's very interesting to emphasize the fact that this representation corresponds to a well-known results of distribution theory in which we can state that a distribution of finite order can be expressed as the sum of a finite number of addends, each one including a function and its derivatives. So in this kind of studies, some important results of distribution theories are implied. We assume that the boundary of our body is constituted of the disjoint union of a finite number of regular faces, So we can observe that two contiguous faces have in common the support of one edge. And we can observe immediately that at least three edges, each edge belongs to the border of each face, that at least three edges converge in a discontinuity point for the tangent vector to the border edge, which is usually referred as wedge. In this study, I will try to add some comments because also on third gradient modeling, because now we are trying to develop some studies also concerning third gradient modeling. In particular, the role of wedges will be important for third gradient modeling. For second gradient, okay, we mentioned here, but we have no condition on at the wedges. So when we can define the orientation of the first boundary of our volume by, of as usual, defining the positive orientation of the outward normal. But we can observe that after once defined the orientation of the outward normal, this orientation induces an orientation also of a positive orientation of the border of each regular face. And what is important here is that when we consider the support of each regular edge, which belongs to the border of each face, we can consider simultaneously each regular edge as belonging to one face or to contiguous face. If we belong this oriented edge as belonging in this figure to the face at the left, we have one orientation. If we consider as belonging to the contiguous face, it possesses the opposite orientation. So we can observe also that each of these regular edges represent a discontinuity loci for the normal vector. And the wedges belonging to the border of each regular face represent a discontinuity point for the tangent. Of course, it's once defined the positive orientation of the boundary, we can consider the surface as the first frontier, the first boundary of the volume. Then the edges as the second frontier, second order frontier of the volume, and finally the wedges as the third order frontier of the volume. It's important to underline also the role that we will show in the development of analytical equation of projectors, surface projectors, in particular the orthogonal projector, which operates, acts on any vector of the environment, projecting orthogonally to the normal space, and the tangent operator, which is to the first, and projects any vector of the ambient space into the tangent space at each point. In the third gradient modeling, also, we will need to introduce edge projector, which in this second gradient modeling are not necessary. And they are defined analogously, but at the level of phase border. I think I have mentioned all the important properties, okay. So, by a variational approach in this study, we were able to derive for this class of materials so-called non-standard boundary condition that we don't know in advance, by decomposed by mainly two analytical tools, the divergence theorem extended to curved surfaces also, and generalized, let's say, and integration by parts that are applied recursively up to obtain non-reducible addends. In particular, it's worth mentioning the so-called biforsa or inner double force. So this new, let's say, non-standard covector, which does work on the normal derivatives of the virtual displacement. So it's typical of higher gradient modeling. These are called k-forces and are defined as the dual quantities which does work on the normal derivatives or on the k order derivatives of the virtual displacement. In this theory, the second gradient modeling, we have only the inner double force or B force. And then we have another non-standard ingredient that is the inner edge force, which is defined in an analogous way, which does work on the virtual displacement, but along the edge. I want to mention here this new ingredient, which is the so-called hyperstress. So a third rank tensor, which is needed to describe the inner virtual work, which possesses two indices, Lagrangian indices, and one Eulerian index. By analytical development that I did here, for brevity, for we have not only a linear, as in Cauchy modeling first gradient linear dependence on the normal, but also a more complex expression is involved, including a divergence of the hyperstress and this entity which represents a surface divergence, let's say a generalization of the concept to curved surfaces, and which makes use of surface projectors, So we can avoid intrinsic representations of the surface, and we can use coordinates in the environment. In the ambient space, so we have the tangent projectors which multiplies the gradient, and another projector is included here inside the arguments, so it projects the argument onto the tangent space. If we develop the projectors in terms of the normal to the surfaces, we can obtain these complex expressions of the contact pressures, in which we can observe the presence of the normal, of some normal gradient, of a product of normal components, and finally we can notice also the presence of the divergence of the normal, which represents the mean curvature. So by this variational approach, we were able to deduce the expression of a contact pressure. What is more important, that explicitly we can obtain a dependence on the mean curvature of the outer face at that point. So after this analytical development, we can finally define which kind of external actions our second gradient body can sustain, which were not a priori known, but are deduced from this variational approach. So we have bulk density forces surface density forces as in Cauchy theory, first gradient theory, but we have also other two external actions, the so-called biforce or double force, which makes works on the normal first normal derivatives of the virtual displacement, and an edge density force, which does work on the virtual displacement along the edge. In third gradient modeling, the external action that can be sustained will be enriched by other kind of external action. So we will have also a second order double force, which makes works on the second normal derivatives. We will have also a edge double force, and we will meet also a wedge condition that here is not yet available. So it's very interesting to consider how the external actions which can be sustained by our body are enriched as we increase the order of the gradient modeling. Yes, thank you. So we can deduce as usual also the strong form of governing equation, and what is interesting at this point, I have indicated the Lagrangian description of this equation, is that the Eulerian description of this equation from the formal point of view are identical. So the problem that we tried to solve is how to transform the governing equation from the Eulerian to the Lagrangian equation. And the consequences of the results that we can obtain, I think, possess a wide range of application. So think to the problem in which you apply forces which are not present at the beginning of your loading history, for instance, a crack propagation problem. How we can express these forces in a Lagrangian description. So the first we proceed by several steps and in immediate results. I will try to do an outline, a general outline. The first results that we have obtained is to specify some relationship to between the Lagrangian virtual gradients and the corresponding Eulerian, and we found them for the second gradient modeling, and in another study more recent I have found also for third gradient modeling. What a result which is rather interesting is these relationships between the hyperstresses of any order, let's say Piola hyperstresses in a Lagrangian description, and the corresponding hyperstresses in the Eulerian description that we can define as Cauchy stress and Cauchy hyperstress. So we can notice a top-down architecture which is typical of this class of materials. So we can observe that the Lagrangian hyperstress affect both the Eulerian hyperstresses of any lower order, not only of the same order but also of lower order. And then we developed the analogous relationship for the third gradient. This architecture is extended and reached, but it is the same. So the hyperstresses of highest order are transformed not only into the corresponding Eulerian hyperstress of the same order, but also they affect also the hyperstress of lower order. And this result is obtained by expressing the inner virtual work in let's say in Eulerian description and in Lagrangian description, since this work should be the same. In this analytical manipulation, we have used a generalization, well-known generalization of divergence problem, and we have achieved a new relationship between Eulerian surface divergence and Lagrangian, which was very useful during the analytical developments. Another important ingredient, which however is well known, is the so-called pullback metric tensor that we can recognize in several of the analytical development I'm going to show. This is an alternative metric tensor in the Lagrangian configuration, which takes into account the deformation gradient and in a sense is induced by the deformation process. And this is very interesting because we assume that in our study an orthonormal basis, but the configuration, but the deformation process induces a sort of curvilinear coordinates which emanates naturally from the deformation process. Another ingredient that we developed as an intermediate was the transformation of the Darboux vectors along the border, so tangent, normal, and another unit vector that is called tangent normal, is not the binormal, because in this modeling it's, we used the Darboux repair mobile, the moving basis of Darboux, so tangent and normal are the same, but then we use another vector which is normal to the tangent but belongs to the tangent plane. These two formula are already known, but we derived two transformation equation for the tangent normal, And this transformation formula are different from the contravariant and covariant representation. In a sense, this transformation formula allows us to transform the vector from the Lagrangian configuration to the Eulerian configuration, and can be regarded as a Gram-Schmidt orthonormalization formula, because if it's true that the deformation gradient transform tangent vector belonging to the Lagrangian configuration into tangent vector belonging to the Eulerian configuration, the orthogonality between the image vector and the tangent is no guarantee. So we are obliged to use this formula to guarantee that the image vector of the tangent normal is still normal to the transformation of the tangent. Then, okay, I go here, we derived some transformation formula for the projector. And this has been a bit difficult because we have obtained some results which are not trivial. So we were able to transform Eulerian projectors into Lagrangian projectors. This is and the complexity of this expression is due to the fact that so a vector which is orthogonal to which is yes orthogonal normal to the tangent plane in the Eulerian configuration possess both components in the Lagrangian descriptions. So just to conclude this overview of the main results that we have obtained, I would like to show you the transformation of one term, emphasizing the fact that the transform of one term of external action, emphasizing the fact that the transformation of the governing equation should be faced globally. What is really surprising is that one Lagrangian, and I will show you, one external action in a Eulerian configuration corresponds in the Lagrangian descriptions to several kinds of external action. And this is not, in my opinion, a trivial result, which has some consequences important for also for subsequent numerical modeling. So in this case, the external B force, a double force, which makes work for the makes works on the normal derivatives of the virtual displacement, we transform the surface integral into in the Eulerian domain into a Lagrangian surface integral. We can transform also the contravariant normal. And then we use this decomposition, additive decomposition in a tangential and normal components, which is crucial in this kind of analytical development. At the end, these are the final results. So one double force contribution to the external virtual work has been transformed in the Lagrangian counterpart, and this was expected, but into also an edge contribution and into a surface divergence. So from one Eulerian action, we have obtained, passing to the Lagrangian configuration, three typologies of external actions. And I think this reveals important properties of this kind of generalized forces that are so important in the higher order gradient modeling. So now we are developing the third gradient modeling, in which the complexity of equation is obviously increased. What just as closing remarks, I think it's important to emphasize that the variational analytical approach allowed us to deduce non-standard boundary conditions, which involves higher order forces, generalized forces, and we were able also to reveal an explicit dependence on the curvature, local mean curvature of the surface. And to achieve this, the final results, we were obliged to obtain intermediate results, which in any case exhibit a certain interest and are represent a basis for next developments. In particular, novel relationships between Eulerian and Lagrangian higher order tensor, hyperstress tensor, useful transformation formulae for the Darboux basis when passing from the Eulerian to the Lagrangian configuration, and some expression emanating from the divergence theorem. For the next developments involving higher order gradient material, these ingredients will be in any case important, and I think they represent useful results from the standpoint of differential geometry. Okay, thank you very much for your interest.